Thank you, Greg, for blessing us with that music. We just want to welcome you all here today to celebrate a life that was so well lived. Jolon was so full of love for his wife, Jessica, and his children, Ella and Owen. We called him not our son-in-law, but our son in love. There are really no words to accurately describe our heartfelt gratitude for the many, many ways that many of you have helped us navigate through this tragic loss. Thank you, Pastor Randy and Anita, for being our spiritual leaders through the first days. We look around this room and we see the most important people in Jolon's life, our dearest of friends that have cared for him, and now you're caring for us. Thank you for holding us tightly in your hugs and not letting go until we let go first, for letting us cry on your shoulders, for feeding us time and time again, and always being there when we needed you. Welcome, and thank you for honoring Jolon. Whether you're here in the sanctuary or you're listening all the way across the continent in Maryland, thank you so much for being here. And we dearly want to thank Sharon and Jolene for all that they did to put this reception together for us. And one curly.
When I remember Jolon, one word comes to mind: enthusiasm. Whether it was on a board lashed to his feet on the top of the cornice, or whether it was a board lashed to his feet behind a boat, shredding up the San Juan or the Escalante rivers, or whether he was locked in on two pedals, trudging up the canyon, or cruising down from Big Bear Lake on his cycle, to take a look at his face, all you saw was joy.
Amen.
And a smile that was as wide as the horizon. We lost a good man. But now he's safe. Shall we pray? Father, we came here today to celebrate a good life, a life that was cut off far, far too short. Father, your children are grieving, and we know that you grieve with us. We ask that you send your Spirit for comfort and for consolation. And yes, many of us ask the question, why? And we know, as did the Apostle Paul, that we look through a dark glass. We can't see all the parts. But we have the promise that one day we will. For now, we have to be patient. Thank goodness that the battle is almost over. We are given three things. We're given hope, we're given faith, we're given love. Father, we trust and hope in all of your promises. We trust and have faith in your mercy. And we trust most of all in your infinite love. Love for every one of us here. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We look all pretty. We look with our shag on there. Anyway, hello. I am Jolon's mother, and this is Jolon's father. We want to share with you a little bit of our son's early life. Jolon Michael Sabo was born June 7, 1976, in Angwin, California. We called him our bicentennial baby. He was beautiful. I know all mothers say that about their babies, but Jolon was beautiful. I was fortunate to be a stay-at-home mom. Jolon was an easy baby, hardly any fuss at all. He loved to cuddle, so we called him our cuddle boy, our cuddle bug, actually, until he was a teenager, of course. He didn't like that after that. We spent a lot of times outdoors. I would put him in the stroller and off we would go on a long run. Jolon would bounce up and down in his stroller, feel the wind in his hair, and laugh and laugh and laugh. In fact, his grandfather used to call him Jolly Jolon. As he grew into childhood, his favorite place to go was the park. So we'd pack a lunch and we would go to the park right here in Loma Linda, a little park over there. And there I taught him to throw the football. And we would play catch for hours. It seemed like hours. Maybe that's why he became an enthusiastic football fan, especially the Chargers. He was definitely an outside boy. He loved everything physical, like we were talking about, water skiing, wakeboarding, snowboarding, running, weight training, basketball, off-road with his motorcycle, and of course, without a doubt, his favorite, cycling. Like mother like son, I guess. God is good, and we thank him for giving us this amazing, loving son, Jolon, even if it was only for 46 years. He will always be our cuddle bug. Sleep well, my son. See you soon. We love you.
So good to see all of you here. This is probably one of the hardest things we've ever had to go through. Jolon celebrated life, and I can remember, and I want us all to remember that what he enjoyed most was his family, and just enjoyed the celebration of life. And I wanted to, again, thank everyone, and we just trust that God has a plan, and we need to rely on him. And again, thank you for all of your support this week. Thank you.
Thank you. It's amazing to see all of your faces and know how much love that we have for Jolon, and just thank you for being here. I'm Melissa, Jolon's sister. I've asked myself hundreds of times whether this is real. Jolon was just always there, steady. And yet I realize he is gone, at least for now, until we meet again in heaven. Jolon was the best brother a sister could ever have. God put him in my life as a steady source of goodness. Between the two of us, I think he'd agree, he was the quiet one, but he was so fun. I love that about him. When he let loose, there wasn't anywhere else I wanted to be. I always knew he wanted me to have a good time too. I loved being his big sister. In the early years, I remember getting on a school bus when we lived in Buffalo, New York. Just him and I on this huge bus. He was in first grade and I was in fourth grade. We'd have a great time sitting in the back where the ride was the bumpiest. Strangely, I don't ever remember anyone else on the bus. When we lived in Chicago, I started to realize how good Jolon was at every outdoor sport he did. He was naturally talented. We played tennis near our home, and while I was better at first, he quickly surpassed me in skill. It was a challenge playing him, and I liked that. He made me a better player. He was also great at ping pong, and we'd have these epic ping pong matches at my grandparents' cabin over the holidays. Fast forward a few years, and Jolon took me to the San Diego Charger games. There we were, screaming our lungs out at the games, not a care in the world. We had one mission, and one mission only, and that was to scream until the Chargers won the game. Jolon's energy, you guys probably all know about that energy when it comes to sports, for the game made me laugh until it hurt. I'd find him and I running up and down the aisles, high-fiving other fans. He'd often tell me who to look for, what plays to watch for, and answered any questions I had. I remember just staring at him in awe because it was so fun, and I wanted the time to stand still. From the moment I got into the car with him, going to the games and back, until the moment I hit the pillow, after the game was over, I smiled and laughed deeply. It's one of my favorite memories of him, with him. When you find that kind of fun, you don't ever want it to end, pure fun, with him through and through. It's freedom. Then there was the infamous drive to Sacramento to pick up Jess. Jolon was never one to brag, but he loved to share certain parts of his life with me. A couple of years ago, while visiting my family, Jolon wanted to show me his car, which I knew virtually nothing about how it worked. I found out pretty quickly. The blinker that farted made me almost pee my pants, and then the karaoke in the car, what? We had 2 hours and 15 minutes of fun. It wasn't just a little singing. We were always all in, the two of us. Song after song, we sang at the top of our lungs. There's no one to judge us in that car, no one to critique our singing. We were all in, feeling free, having passion for life, pure fun. By the time we got to the airport in Sacramento, our voices were toast. Remember Jess? She came into the car, she's laughing with us. It was so worth it. Me and my little brother I admired so much. Then there were the times he'd patiently help me with my computer issues. I bet there's a lot of you out there who were graced with Jolon's patience to help you with computer issues. I had plenty through the years, and every single time he'd slow down, patiently troubleshoot, and solve the issue. Recently, I had texted him about how he had the patience of a saint when it comes to technology and computer issues, and that I needed his help once again. His reply was a funny video he had made years ago of him and a few other coworkers beating on an old copy machine. Needless to say, my frustration for computer problems immediately evaporated. There was Jolon again, steady Jolon, making me laugh. And yes, he helped me set up a second monitor, to which I thanked him and joked, I'd never be able to go back to working with a single monitor again. He said I could have four monitors if I wanted. Just recently, over Thanksgiving, he wanted to share with me what he was up to at work. He, in his quiet way, was sharing his love by including me in his life. I sat with him in our dad's office, and he showed me the different things he was overseeing. I enjoyed every second of sitting with him and listening. There's a lot to admire. There are many words I'd like to say, but the most important ones are, I know I will see him in heaven. He was a good, compassionate person, and I miss him terribly. I love you, Jolon. Life is precious. He knew it. We all know it. While he'd be so embarrassed by all of us talking about him right now, he deserves all of the goodness that comes from us. In so many ways, we all admired him. Healthy, fun, kind, steady. In those times where I grieve for him, I realize just what a legacy he has left behind. His kids, Ella and Owen, he was an amazing father to you both, and I know you know that. We love you both so much, and his precious wife, Jess. Your relationship was amazing, and we love you so deeply. As a family, we will navigate this together. We will never be alone, and God is with us. Jolon would want us to live life well as he did, so we must. Let's remember just how much God is all around us. Romans 8:37-39 says, "No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." God is love. God is with us through this journey. And I encourage all of us to come to God every day and accept his love and his peace. For he truly is the source of a life well lived. See you in heaven, Jolon. I love you.
My name is Zach Thorpe. My wife and Jolon's wife are sisters. I first met Jolon in 1994. He had moved into, I was a sophomore at PUC. I'd lived in the corner room at Granger Hall. It was a three bunk dorm room. I was on the second bunk, and Jolon and Stephen lived in the room next door. And I had only lived in the room about a week, and I was going to sleep, and my ears were sort of against the wall, and I was like, is that Vanilla Ice? I never heard so much Vanilla Ice or Boys to Men or Green Day in my entire life. It was very clear that first year that I met Jolon that he liked music, and if you knew Jolon at all, you know that he loved it so much that years later he had a turntable at his house where he actually mixed music with turntables. I mean, if you've ever seen someone do that, it quite honestly is an art to be able to match tempos and music and keys and all of these things, and he thought it was amazing and he loved it. Years later, when Jesse and Jolon were dating, we actually went on a family ski trip with the Wagners, and Jolon had brought his boat out. And Jolon being a skier and I being a skier, I thought, well, we're just gonna go out for a ski. Well, we happened to find a ski course, and Jolon said, well, let's do the course. And so we were on our way in his boat to the course. It was just he and I. And he said, here's the speed that I want. And this is how far off I want you to go, and here is the music that I want you to play. Okay. And so we'd go through the course, and it was at that point that I understood that Jolon embraced this thing that I sort of call the element of the push. It was basically, how hard can you push yourself? And how hard can you go? And then when you get to that point, can you go a little bit further? And I found that out because he was so many lengths off, and we'd get through the course and he'd pass through and he'd say, okay, let's go a little bit faster and we'll shorten the road just a little bit more. And that was the thing that sort of like began to be the thing that I noticed about him, this element of the push. It would be his birthday and he would say, I do as many push-ups as the years that I'm turning. And I'd say, oh, okay, so you're turning 46 this year, you're gonna do 46 push-ups today. Yeah, that's what I'm gonna do, because he embraced this element of the push. So when he started riding bicycles, I had been riding bicycles for a very long time at that point, and it was problems for me because Jolon's thing was, how hard could you ride? And it was this element of the push. So when we are on a group ride and we were going harder, it was literally like, okay, this is really hard. I'm happy with the pace that we're going. And Jolon would go, but just a little bit more, right? Let's see how hard we can go, this element of the push. And so there are group rides in this area that happen on a fairly frequent basis, and he would go just a little bit harder and just a little bit more, and he and I would sort of like compete with each other, and he would try to go harder than me, and we'd get done with the ride, and he was always the first person to say, hey man, that was a really great job, great time, you know, you did, that was awesome, you dropped me on this particular point, or, you know, more often than not, there were times where he would drop me because he embraced this element of the push. So when there was this technological advance called Strava that came out, which basically allowed you to map a certain section of a ride that you would do, and then you could compete with anyone else in the world, quite honestly, if they would do that section, Jolon was all over it. The Redlands Classic comes through Redlands every year, and at times it goes up through Oak Glen. And so Jolon would come to me and he would say, hey, went after the section on Oak Glen. And I think I've got the local time, and I think I'm the first one on top, and from people who live locally. And I remember going home and going, I bet you I could beat that. So there's this thing on this app, if you have this app, that if you win this section or this time, then you get a little thing called the King of the Mountain, and you get this little crown, and it sits next to your name, and it makes you feel really great. But if you lose that King of the Mountain thing, there you get this email that says, you've been dethroned. And so I went out, and I did the thing, and I beat the time, and I loaded it up, and I went, I know he's going to get this email that says, you've been dethroned. And the next day, I got an email that said, you've been dethroned. And I remember thinking, I wonder what music he was listening to when he was doing it. You know, the reality is that no matter what sport you do, someday you're going to get beat. And as Jolon and I would sort of go back and forth on these things, my son Tyler was starting to ride bikes, and there was a point at which he started to beat me. And Jolon would say, hey, old man, what's up with your son beating you? And I said, oh yeah, well, I think Ella likes to ride bikes too, so someday she's gonna beat you. Because someday it's going to come to you. And we both agreed that wouldn't it be great if the people who passed us were our kids? You know, as Christians, we have this faith and this hope that this isn't the end. But we also have this grief. And in the last few weeks, I've had someone say to me, grief is just love without a place to go. But that happens for a time. So when we were out on our last ski trip, I was sitting down on the patio with Jolon, and he had brought out his turntables and all of his music, and it was sitting up on the top. And I heard this on the top of the thing, and I looked at him and I said, who's doing the music? And he's like, oh, that's Owen. He's way better than me. And I know for a fact that he took Ella out on a ride this year, and he came home and said, Jesse, I think it's my year. she somehow has figured it out, and I think she's going to be faster than me this year. He's passed those things on. So I think that there is this idea of love, and it lives on, and it lives on in the next generation, and it lives on in our family. And quite honestly, it makes me smile. And the reason why it makes me smile is because I think it would make Jolon smile as well.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ryan Lauer. I have the pleasure of calling Jolon one of my best friends. I'm joined by Carrie Lichty and Jason Gatling. And, you know, seeing so many people here from so many different parts of Jolon's life, I think really is just the truest testament to how amazing of a person he was and how special he was to all of us. I agree with what Melissa said. I think Jolon would be embarrassed to see us all here. He'd probably just wonder why we're making such a big deal out of everything. Jolon was a man who went through life simply and humbly just doing the right thing. And that made me proud to be his friend. Jesse asked a few of us, from the grown-up Jolon friend group, to speak a little bit about this side of who he was. Some of us have known Jolon for 30 plus years, some of us a little bit less. Many of us have had our lives come into sync with his over the past 8 to 10 years. As we've seen our kids and our families grow in church and school, the 8 or 10 families have just shared countless activities together. We were together all the time, almost every weekend doing something as a group, as families, just sharing life together. I heard once that you don't really know someone until you spend time with them before they brush their teeth in the morning. And I had the privilege of getting to know Jolon before he brushed his teeth in the morning. Fortunately for all of us, we only grew to love Jolon more and more the more time we spent with him, no matter what time of day. Seeing him pop his head up out of his sleeping bag on the roof of the houseboat at Lake Powell, well before sunrise, mind you, and kind of hurry tiptoe down to the boat and go out for a ski on the lake while it was smooth as glass, will always be one of my best memories of Jolon. Our families have had some amazing times together, all of us. Skiing and snowboarding at Mammoth in Utah, bike rides on the Santa Ana River Trail and all over. Jesse called this the 007 group because a group of the guys got together and decided we're gonna watch all the James Bond movies in order together, and we didn't make it far enough through them with Jolon there. It's gonna be tough to finish without him, but we will. Number of us have spent 24/7 for a week with Jolon on the Frugal Frigate houseboat at Lake Powell. And I don't know how you ended up with a boat that was practically named after Jolon, as the Frugal Frigate. It's fate, I think. Many of us also got to do this crazy thing called the Ragnar. A few of us have our shirts on to honor Jolon today. For those who don't know, the Ragnar is a team relay running race that lasts for about 30 hours of continuous running. Someone's always running from the team. 12 of us, plus support crew. Jesse injured herself training. Jolon injured himself training. I think we all injured ourselves training one way or another. We piled into 2 vans with 6 runners in each van and traded off running from spot to spot all over Orange and San Diego counties. Of course, Jolon was the team captain. He lived for this sort of thing. He had so much fun planning who was going to do what route, who was the best runner for which route. He knew all of our strengths and weaknesses and lined us up with the route that was going to be best for us. It was fun to see his silly and fun and competitive side. One of my absolute favorite photos of Jolon was taken in his hotel room the night before the race when he snuggled into bed with the life-size photo faces of the team and a goofy grin on his face as if everyone had joined him under the covers. Such a character. The last thing I'd like to leave y'all with about my friend Jolon is how he inspired me, and I'm sure so many of us here today, to be the best version of ourselves. Who wasn't jealous of Jolon in one thing or another? He was consistent and persistent about his diet and his fitness. I mean, the best I know. An amazing athlete, an amazing father. We've all seen his dedication to his kids, teaching his kids, his passion for cycling and so many other things. Just in January, his son and my son were taking a couple girls to the banquet, and came time to end the banquet and come home, and I said, hey, you know, the boys could just bring Owen home, it'll be fine. And Jolon texted me back and he said, would it be all right if I went down there and got the two boys and the two girls and showed them how to take their dates home properly at the end of a date? And that was the kind of dad Jolon was. He wasn't just looking out for his own kid, he was looking out for mine too. My son Noah asked me to include here how he felt like Jolon was always there for him when he needed another dad around. He was a dad to all of them, all these kids here, and we love him for that. Jolon's deep love for his soulmate, Jesse, was always evident to me. Even in the chaos of our VRBO ski rental with 25 of us crammed in there, he managed to find time to squeeze in close and give Jesse a hug and share a tender moment with her from time to time. Some of us were watching. He was a friend whenever you needed him. He'd borrow tools, come give me a hand with projects, help out around the house, loan his trailer, always there. I have no doubt that Jolon will continue to live on in my heart and in all of ours and still be there whenever we need him. We're gonna miss you so much, Jolon.
My name is Jason Gatling, and it's an honor to honor Jolon. I wore this shirt today not because I am a cyclist, because I am not. There are so many that are well better cyclists than I. I was the weekend cyclist, which meant that I was trying to keep up from behind. But my buddy Jolon would always seem to roll back. How you doing? You keeping up? Yep. I would say maybe breathlessly as I was trying my best to smile as he was looking like he was at ease and I was not. So I wrote down a couple of things. Our family has been blessed to get to know the Sabo family over the past many years, and I'd like to honor Jolon, Jesse, Ella, and Owen in saying three things that immediately came to mind when I thought of Jolon. Hospitality, helpfulness, and hugs. Hospitality. Jolon and Jesse opened their home in a variety of different ways, whether it was a party, after an event, hey, come on over, let's, you know, I've got some cookies or something. They opened their home in many different ways, and that warm hospitality is noticed and always goes far. These friendship groups that we all have in our lives are so important, and that hospitality was so blessed for me and our family. Helpfulness. expertise in electronics. It's been said, you know, that Jolon knew how to fix stuff and put that stuff together. He helped my electronic questions, my AV questions. Hey, you can, you know, try this or put this together, and I appreciated that. Helpfulness with his time. He was never stingy with his time. If you asked him, hey, Jolon, I need a little help with something, and he seemed to have expertise, or hey, we can look that up, or hey, I think there's an idea that we could try. Helpfulness physically. We had the opportunity to bike ride with families in the Holdercrux area several times, and the memory that sticks out to me is how many times did Jolon come up from behind and help somebody up the hill? Yes, I think I was probably on the receiving end of that maybe once or twice, but my favorite memory is of Jolon pushing. I was struggling, and Jolon came behind and said, hey, can I help you push my daughter Maddie up the hill? Maddie might have been 8 or 10 years old, and we had some tears that we were trying to get to that last top of that last hill. And Jolon just sped up, took her to the top of the hill, and when he got to the top, he said, hey, Maddie, good job. You did that all by yourself. And the smiles that happened because somebody helped her get to the top. Lastly is hugs. My last memory of Jolon was giving him a hug earlier this January when we had an after Christmas friends party where we just kind of met at our home. And at the end of the night, as everybody was leaving in different ways, I remember Jolon walking by and walking and giving a big, big monster hug and saying, hey, can't wait to see you again soon. That's my memory, and those are the things that I loved about Jolon. I can't wait to get to heaven. I know we're going to have a bike ride, and we're going to be going, as a big friendship group, we're going to be going down those streets of gold. We're going to go past the sea of glass. We're going to go past the pearly gates. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. I can't wait to see you and my friend Jolon.
So I'm here to represent the band of ladies. Who knew and loved Jolon during the 007 years. And ladies, I guess that makes us Bond girls. Jolon, like colon with a J, he would tell you when first introduced. Jolon was all in for all things in life. A multi-sport athlete, he spun his wheels on dirt and road, cut the glass surface of Powell's waters, and carved snow-packed sides of mountains. He was poetry in motion, and easily reached peak performance in all his athletic endeavors. While there was plenty he could have boasted about, he always carried on with a quiet and humble confidence. As a friend, it was easy to wonder how you could share life's adventures with Jolon while having such unmatched abilities. But Jolon selflessly and graciously would slow his pace, lend a push, and cheer encouragements to his lesser able buddies. Jolon was fully involved and invested as dad to Ella and Owen. You could easily spot him on the sidelines of school sports events. He'd clear his schedule to take part in banquet pictures and escorts and spent countless hours in the saddle petted alongside his pride and joy. He poured unconditional love over them, was their biggest cheerleader, and made quality time with each a priority. There was no doubt how proud he was of each of them. Jolon shared the perfect love story with his wife, Jessie. Committed partners in all things life through their way, he admired and adored her. The sparkle in his eye for his girl, Jessie, was undeniable. He was a hero to each of our children. an encourager, mentor, and certainly a model of upstanding character. But they'd be quickest to tell you that Jolon knew how to have fun. Bike rides, gel blaster battles in the orange groves, dance parties, DJed by Smooth as Glass, and endless hours of being pulled, shaken, and stirred across Lake Powell by their favorite captain, Jolon. His imprint on the lives of our families will be ineffable. A brother in Christ, he lived by and shared his faith. He was salt and light to the world. And while he spent his time like gold, we cannot help but think that Jolon finished this race too soon. Until we meet again on that great day, we will be missing you.
Hi, I'm Ella. Jolon's my dad. So, you know, it's hard to think of things to say. Like, what do you say about your best friend, your cheerleader, your role model, your dad? Dad, you were the one who got me. You got my jokes, my problems, and understood my messed up humor. My goodness, am I gonna miss your stupid dad jokes you would send me on Instagram. Dad, you were the only person that could convince me to do an 8-hour mountain bike race with you. And thanks to you, I've learned to be frugal and only start the washing machine after 9 p.m. to dodge peak electricity hours, of course. Oh, and that Instacart is a ripoff. I'd make you film stupid TikTok dances with me, and I'd laugh as you tried to learn the moves. I loved it. You never told me that dress is pretty or that outfit's pretty. It was always, you make that dress look pretty. Dad, I'm gonna miss your hugs on the sideline of football games and after races. But I'm so glad I got to have you as long as I did. Lastly, Dad, you most importantly reminded me to take a step back and just enjoy the moment wherever I was. You always lived every day to the fullest because you said, well, you never know what could happen tomorrow. I think you truly, truly live by that motto, and I know you're proud of how you lived your life. I wish you were here to see who I'll grow up to be, but Dad, I cannot wait to make you proud. I love you, Dad, and I can't wait to ride with you, laugh with you, and hug you again. Till next time, Ella.
Dad, I'm gonna miss you. But don't worry, I've got a bunch of other dads that'll help me. Love you, Dad.
All right, I see a lot of good swag out there. He'd be very proud. My thoughts on my night in spandex, the cycling kind of spandex. Over the past 23 years, Jolon and I, with God's hand at the wheel, became black belts in keeping it simple and living in the moment. So I just want to take this second to just point out all of the joy that you all have mentioned that he loved in living in the moment. So I know he would want us to move forward and live in the moment and just live in the joy. Now, don't get me wrong. We found plenty of things to disagree about, for sure. Like my dishes left all over the house with just this much juice left in the bottom. Or his stinky cycling jerseys piled up, waiting for just one more before he started the load. Now, instead of making these things into an argument, he'd intentionally make it playful. He'd go around the house, pick up all of those glasses, line them up on the counter, send me a picture of that with a smile emoji. And then I'd rebut with a picture of his stinky jerseys with a vomit emoji. The simplicity in keeping it simple came in the unspoken recognition that in the end, that stuff didn't matter. We loved each other fiercely. And without reservation. Maybe not always publicly so, but it was the little looks, the side eyes, the jokes that were just ours. We just knew we were always going to be. Our relationship with God has had a similar simplicity, fierce faith, and living intentionally in each blessing. We just knew that God knew He was our rock. I haven't spoken yet with God about all this. I'm not mad. I just haven't had the right words until sitting down to figure out what to say today. Also, this would have been a prayer that he and I would have had together on our pillow at night. So here goes. This is what I think we would have prayed. Gracious Father, thank you for smushing 100 lifetimes of happiness into a short blink. Thank you for 2 awesome kids. Thank you for making one of them look just like him. And thank you for making the other one mirror his personality. Thank you for making Jolon into the kind of man upon which Ella will measure the eligibility of her future spouse. And an example for Owen of how to be a great husband and father. Thank you for gifting us a week alone in Jamaica a few weeks before he died. Thank you for the day before he died. He went on a really long, very cold bike ride with Ella. He played video games with Owen in the evening. And that evening he told me how content he was in all parts of his life. And how if Jamaica was so fun, imagine how our retirement will be. Thank you for making his final exit quick. He wouldn't have wanted it any other way. Thank you for your hands at work in our village. Ella, Owen, and my feet have not touched the ground since he died. I know we have your promise, Lord, that we'll see him again. But if it's okay with you, I'm going to intentionally find him in each day by savoring every moment. Amen. I can count on one hand the number of times I've journaled in my life. It's just living in the moment, just not writing things down. But as I was making the slideshow that you're going to see next, I came across one such entry. Jolon and I were dating. He was heading back up to PUC because I was down here in my freshman year of dental school, and he had a few more quarters to finish off his degrees. So here's what my 22-year-old self mused. I was doing okay emotionally until the very few items were being loaded into his Honda Accord. Then it hit me like a ton of bricks. Bam. Jolon was leaving me for months. Andrea Bocelli was playing in the background. In fact, Jolon danced with me in the family room, and I didn't even have to ask him to dance. So romantic. Then as I was hugging him in the house, the song, "It's Time to Say Goodbye," started to play. I lost it. I suddenly had this feeling rush over me. What if he got into an accident on the way up, and this was my last chance to say everything I ever wanted to say? I got a little panicked, but then Jolon, in his cool and calm way, assured me that everything was going to be fine. And if it didn't go fine, then we had God to see us through that. We prayed, and he left. Well, my love, I think this qualifies as something that didn't go fine, but we said and lived everything we needed to say to each other. God's got us. And don't worry, I won't start the appliances before 9 p.m.
You walk, you run, you climb, and you fall again. You crawl, you fight, you break apart tonight. But I am the voice that keeps on calling out to you, lighting up the dark. I turn chaos into art. So if you're falling under, or if you're letting go,
so I now then take you, Jesse, as my wife. I love you.
Looking back,
if love was a color,
on the memory of
it would be the color of your eyes.
The dance we shared. Neath the stars above,
big brown eyes,
for a moment all the world was right. How could I have known that you'd ever say goodbye? And now I'm glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way to miss the dance.
love you forever, unconditionally.
You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from a nice warm bed, you just remember what your old pal said, boy. You've got a friend in me. Now you've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. You got the trouble.
Go, we go, last stretch. Go, 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 go.
There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We stick together and I see through. 'Cause you've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me.
Some other folks might be a little bit smarter than I am. Stronger too, maybe, but none of them will ever love you the way I do, just me and you, boy.
And as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny.
Was a powerhouse, and I remember when I was a lot younger that he would push me up the hills or give me a little boost.
And he mapped out a ride, and at the end of the trail we ended at a private property community, and we pushed our bikes under the gate, and then we were escorted out by a police car.
Thanks for the bike rides and for never leaving me in the dust. I'm a better person having known you.
Looked up to him because he was one of the healthiest people I knew, and I wanted to be as healthy as him and to have the same passion for fitness.
I hope when the crowd screams out, they're screaming your name.
I hope if everybody runs, you choose to stay. I hope that you fall in love and hurt so bad. The only way you can know, you give it all you had. And I hope that you don't suffer, but take the pain. I hope when your moment comes, you'll say, I did it all. I did it all. I owned every second that this world could give. Saw so many places, the things that I did. Yeah, with every broken bone, I swear I live. Hope that you spend your days, but they all add up.
Favorite thing about Mr. Jolon was that he was always so kind and would always take the time to talk to me.
You made me feel so special by remembering my favorite food, steak. I'm so glad we have so many fun memories together.
His love for music. He especially loved EDM music. If you don't know what it is, it's electronic dance music. So like beep beep poop poop, that kind of music.
Ran out of gas and we had to push the boat back.
I remember Jolon taking us out on early morning skis at Lake Powell and getting in the freezing water with me to help me learn.
He would always take us water skiing at Lake Powell, and he would always tell me to go as many times as I wanted, and that it was okay because we had all day. And he told us that, you know, we could still go look for glass.
It was early evening on Monday, January 30. I was sitting in a somewhat dark hotel room out of town attending professional meetings. It's kind of dark because I could look out at the lights of the city. It's beautiful. And then I got a text. It was a text from Marion Wagner. And I couldn't believe what it said. She said, "Bob and I are headed home. Our hearts are broken." It's the kind of news that doesn't register. I made several phone calls. And I just thought, this can't be. Jolon? I just greeted Jesse and Jolon at church a few days ago. Lean and healthy Jolon. Jesse's Jolon. Ella and Owen's Jolon. Therapists say that denial is the first stage, or they call it numbness or shock or other such technical terms. To me, it just wasn't real. Just wasn't real. Over the next hours and days, I did a lot of thinking, Jesse. Thinking back to when Anita and I were talking with a search committee from Loma Linda University Church, questioning their judgment, but thankful. And Marion Wagner said, "I'd like you to talk to some young adults." So she set up a meeting in what was Bill Lovelace's office. And we sat and talked, Jesse, Jolon, and several others. Matt and Melissa, I think you were there as well, or Melissa, you were. I don't think you realized what an impact that made on me. Just the high caliber, high quality young adults that would be a part of this community. Our paths intersected many, many times after that. I sat here and I took in what the ones of you who have spoken far more eloquently than I, listen to what you've had to say. Watch the pictures on the screen. A life well lived. Jesse, when we were talking about this day, something you said stood out to me, and it's something that has been borne out in what has been said here today. It's something you said about Jolon, about the way he lived his life. And I realized when you were saying it that it's something that the old wise man of Israel talked about. That old wise man who penned books such as Proverbs, Song of Songs, and then Ecclesiastes. They say, stay away from Ecclesiastes, because if you're having a bad day, it'll send you over the cliff, but I'm having kind of a bad day, so that's where I'm going. Jesse, you said he lived in the moment. That's how Jolon lived his life. He lived in the moment. So I want to read you some words from Solomon. These are taken from Eugene Peterson's paraphrase, The Message, who captures, it seems to me, particularly well the sentiment of what Solomon is saying. In The Message, it is given the heading, Make the Most of What God Gives. Here are the words, chapter 5, verses 18 to 20. After looking at the way things are on this earth, here's what I've decided is the best way to live. Take care of yourself, have a good time, and make the most of whatever job you have for as long as God gives you life. And that's about it. That's the human lot. Yes, we should make the most of what God gives, both the bounty and the capacity to enjoy it, accepting what's given and delighting in the work. It's God's gift. God deals out joy in the present, the now. It's useless to brood over how long we might live. Wow. It's almost verbatim, Jesse, what you said. Did you catch that line? God deals out joy in the present, the now. Live in the moment. In a certain sense, it's the same thing Jesus would say centuries later. When Jesus, on that grassy knoll looking over the beauty of the Sea of Galilee, would utter those words that would become known forever after as the Sermon on the Mount, he included a segment in those words that go like this. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble on its own. Here's how one person reflecting on those words put it. The good news. Don't worry about the things that haven't happened yet. Live in the moment. Leave your worries for tomorrow. There's much to be learned from people who live their lives that way. Much to be learned. Certainly the wise man Solomon and Jesus himself knew what they were talking about when they stated what would later become a mantra for Jolon and Jesse's life and their life with Ella and Owen. Live in the moment. Live in God's now. As I was thinking about that, it seems like there are many reasons to do that. I would like to just point to three. Three reasons why living in the now matters, living in the moment is important. The first one is because when you live in the moment, you live well. You see, there's such a penchant on the part of us as human beings to live regretfully in the past or anxiously in the future. And when we do that, we miss now. But now is the moment God has given us. Now. Now and now and now. We move through time in a vehicle called now. Those who learn that lesson best live life best. You sense it when you're around them. All you had to do was to listen to Jolon's family and friends as they talked about him, as they talked about the joy of living in the now. You don't live regretfully then, because you can't change then. You don't live anxiously then, because you have no control over then. You live now the gift that God has given you, and those who do so well. Jesus, in that same sermon, speaking in the present tense, that's the tense of now, said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All the rest, you'll get that thrown in." But right now, seek first his kingdom, walk with him today, live with him now, and you will live well. It seems to me that's one of the important reasons why living now matters. People who live now live well. A second reason why living now matters is when you live now, you grieve well. You grieve well. Grief is a healthy emotion. It's a necessary endeavor when we lose something that matters to us, when we lose someone who matters to us. It's an important facet of being alive, of being human, of being a child of God. Throughout the entire scripture, if you read the story of God's people, you find people who grieved, including Jesus, including God himself. People who grieved losses, grieved and sorrowed. That's the way we human beings were designed, to release the stress and the tension that builds up in our hearts when we experience sadness. But to grieve in the now means that I don't try to discern what I cannot discern about how long will this take? Is there something else? I'm getting overwhelmed. I don't know what to do next. It's one of those strange realities of life, but true ones, that God gives us enough strength for today. He doesn't promise us strength for tomorrow, promises us strength for today. It's kind of like the Israelites. I've been reading again of their trek out of Egypt. And it's kind of like their experience with the manna. Manna, 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 every day, manna. But they quickly learned it was only for the day. Nothing for tomorrow, nothing left over from yesterday, but ample for today. When you grieve today, God will give you strength today. Now, the truth is, Jesse and Owen and Ella, the way God gives strength is through the people that surround you. I don't deny that God's Spirit moves in our hearts and lives. Certainly that is true. But God has chosen, for God's own reasons, to use human beings as his primary agents. It will be the hearts of others, the hands of others, the help of others, the hope of others that will often be enough to sustain you, not for tomorrow, but for today. When you live now, you live well and you grieve well. But thirdly, it seems to me that when you live for now, you trust well. You trust well. One of the ways that we can best put our trust in someone else is we depend on what they say. We put stock in what they say. We put confidence in what they say. Their word means something to us. I suspect, Ella and Owen, that was true for you. Dad saying, "I'll be there at 4, and except for that last day when he couldn't, he was there. This is the best way to do it. You could put stock in that. We trust someone when we put stock in what they say. And so to trust well means that we put stock in what God says. If we trust God, then His word matters. It counts to us. There are many things that God underlines in His word that can matter at a moment, at a time like this. But certainly we have to think about words like, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." To trust well means that we put stock in what God says. Now, and now, and now again. Day after day after day. Until that day when it is reality. No longer, Jesse, as your dad said, quoting Paul, seeing through a glass darkly, but face to face. He lived in the moment. It's a beautiful and a healthy way to live. Jesus recommended it. The wise man spoke of it. There may be many reasons for that, but among them must certainly be because when you live in the now, you live well, you grieve well, you trust well. There's one other passage in Ecclesiastes, one more statement that catches my attention. I thought of it fairly soon after I had heard about Jolon. It's a statement that, with pain in my heart and tears in my eyes, reminds me of Jolon. Ecclesiastes 7, verse 1. "A good reputation is better than a fat bank account. Your death date tells more than your birth date." Wise words. We profoundly grieve Jolon's death. We tenaciously cling to Jesus' promise. We tearfully but gratefully celebrate Jolon's life. But if, as the wise man says, your death date tells you more than your birth date, what might January 30, 2023 tell us? Maybe it tells us that the value, the influence, the impact of a life is told not in years, but in moments. Not in length, but in love. Not in how long it lasted, but in how far it reaches. And those tell us that this was indeed a life deeply well lived. As I looked at those pictures, I thought, in our hearts, in our minds, in your memories as a family, Jolon will be forever young. Forever young. Until that day that Jesus comes again and awakens him, and he will arise to be forever young. Gracious God, we are grateful, grateful beyond words for a life well lived, a life that impacted, influenced, and touched so many. And we are grief-stricken at his loss. Lord, let those of us here who are in different ways on the sidelines of Jesse's and Ella's and Owen's life, let us lend our support to them, that through our hands and our hearts, they might know your hope. We pray that your grace and your spirit, we pray that your hope and your consolation would sustain each person here, now and until the day we meet again. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to invite you, if you would be so kind as to remain seated, as Jolon's family is given the opportunity to exit the sanctuary. And then if you would join them for a reception. If you are new to this community, you will exit the front doors that are that way of the sanctuary, and you will turn right and go to the building that will be just in front of you, downstairs, and then back this direction. They will be happy to greet you there.